Hey, party people, it's Lycona DiCicci, and welcome to the Easy Peasy Guide for Eden's Promise, Eternity Savage, Phase 1, or better known as the Door Boss from E12S. Before we start, go ahead and click on the like button and subscribe to the channel so more adventurers like you can help get their clears. It takes less than a GCD to click on those buttons, but no matter how you support the channel, it's cool by me. So, let's get started. Keep in mind that there are several different strategies for handling these mechanics, so I'll just be going over the ones we use to get our clear. The marker placement for this fight must be placed exactly in these locations for the strategies in this guide to work. The positioning of your characters on the stage are so precise that even one step out of place will wipe your party. You'll want to form two groups consisting of a tank, a healer, and two DPS, and assign left, right, or north and south save spots for each group. You can also loosely use your clock positions to dodge certain AoEs, but it's not necessary for getting through the mechanics. First up is Obliteration, which is a raid-wide AoE, and then she'll dive into our memories and introduce us into the main mechanics of this fight. Six crystals will appear containing all the memories of the primals we fought in the last Shadowbringer raids. Starting from the left, we have Titan, Leviathan, Garuda, Ramu, Ifrit, and Shiva. The boss will tether to these crystals throughout the fight. Different mechanics will come out depending on which crystals she's tethered to and what ability she's casting. So let's go over the middle four first, as these crystals will always produce the same AoE mechanic on the stage, whereas Titan and Shiva have their own special mechanics. These middle four crystals will place AoEs on the stage in certain positions. For Leviathan, it will be two line AoEs on the outside. For Garuda, she'll put down her AoEs in a cross pattern like this. Ramu will place an AoE around the boss, and Ifrit will place his AoEs down like this. When the boss tethers to two of these crystals, their AoEs come out and at the same time, they overlap each other. For our group, we use specific callouts to determine where the safe spots are and to minimize confusion. Here are the different combinations. Leviathan and Garuda, Intercardinals and In. Leviathan Ramu, North-South Out. Leviathan and Ifrit, Sides and In. Garuda and Ramu, Intercardinals and Out. Ifrit and Ramu, Sides and Out. Now that we understand the AoEs coming from the crystals that the boss tethers to, let's continue the fight. She'll then cast either Junction Shiva or Junction Titan. For Shiva, it's a spread mechanic, and for Titan, you'll want to stack with your party groups. She'll then cast Rapturous Reach, which will be either a left or a right side cleave. Also notice here that for this cleave, it's not just a 180 degree cleave, it's a little bit more than that. Just be careful as the shape of this cleave plays into how you handle a few mechanics later on. Right after her cleave, the Shiva or Titan junction will go off, so either stack with your groups for Titan, or spread out relative to your clock positions for Shiva. Next, she'll cast Cast. This is where you look at the two tethers attaching themselves to the crystals. In this case, it was Intercardinals and Outside. Don't forget, her cast here can be any of the different tether combinations that we looked at before. Right after you dodge those AoEs, you'll either have to spread out again for Shiva or stack again for Titan. She'll then cast Formless Judgment, which is a tank buster. Tanks should stand together and provoke during the cast. She'll hit both tanks twice, giving each tank two different debuffs. She'll hit like a truck here, so big mitigation is needed. Next, she'll cast Obliteration, which is the raid-wide AoE, and then she'll cast Junction Shiva and then Diamond Dust. Everyone should stand under the boss and prepare to slide to the safe spot once the stage turns to ice. Two healers will get AoE stack markers on them, so you'll want to slide with your party groups here. The safe spots always appear on the opposite side of each other, so for us, we have a group that slides towards the northern safe spot, and a group that slides towards the southern safe spot. If the safe spots are east and west, we set conditionals for both groups. Our south group goes west, and our north group goes east. Another way to look at it is that since I'm in the south group, I just look at the blue and purple markers, and wherever the safe spot lands on those markers, that's where I slide to. Same with the yellow and the red markers for the folks who slide north. Once you slide to those first safe spots, an AoE will appear on the safe spot, so you'll have to slide out of it again. Since we're in our tank, healer, and DPS groups, we have the range and healers slide out sideways along the edge, left and right, and the two melee slide towards the boss's hit ring. Here's the final positions everyone should end up in roughly. As those purple AoEs go off on everybody, giant icicles will drop down on each person. You'll get a tether attached to you from a random icicle. Moments later, you'll get the same AoE pattern as our first slide, where the safe spots are on the edges opposite of each other. Head into the middle for heals, and then get into one of the safe spots. Same as before, those sneaky AoEs will appear in those safe spots, but stay here for a moment until the other AoEs disappear. Pop your anti-knockbacks here, as the middle of the stage will light up with a knockback animation. Move a bit back into the middle for another set of heals, and then you'll want to run away from your tether and turn it into a purple one like this. Make sure you also don't overlap anyone else and don't stand on another person's tether. There's really not a set strategy for positioning your tethers here. As one of our raid friends said when they cleared it before us, you just kinda get it after you do it once or twice. Also, you don't have to stand too far away from each other as the icicle damage from that tether hit is pretty skinny. Next, she'll cast Obliteration, and then she'll cast Junction Titan. She'll cast Earthen Fury, which is a hard-hitting raid-wide AoE that will change the stage into Earth. If you remember the mechanics from E4S, Titan bombs will fall down on the outside of the arena, and folks will soon get markers above their heads, an orange square, a yellow triangle, or a blue marker. They'll carry the same mechanical properties as in E4S. The people with orange squares must stack together with at least one other person who has an orange square, the people with the yellow triangles eats theirs alone and they cause a small explosion, while the person with the blue triangle eats theirs alone with a big explosion. There will be three sets of bombs that come out and three sets of markers that the entire party will get. We have to use these markers to destroy all the bombs around the arena, so let's go over those positions for the three sets. For this first set, four people will get the orange square, three people will get the yellow triangles, and one person will get the blue triangle. The person with the blue triangle will always go to C. The DPS with the orange squares go to A, the DPS with the yellow triangle goes to D, the tanks and healers with the orange markers go to 1, while the tank with the yellow triangle goes to B, and the healer with the yellow triangle goes to 2. For all the marker placements, you'll want to stand in this little spot here, and you'll see your character attach itself to the bomb that's right next to you. Once the marker mechanic goes off, the bomb should be destroyed. Come back into the middle for heals, and let's get ready for the second set. On the second set, six people will get the orange squares on their heads, and two people will get the blue markers. Tanks and healers with the orange squares will go stack at 1, the 3 DPS with the orange squares will stack at A, while one blue triangle goes to the 2 marker and the other blue triangle goes to the C marker. For the people with the orange squares, you can flex a little bit just in case you're out of position, but just make sure you're stacking with at least one other person who has an orange square. After the second set goes off, come back to the middle again for heals and prepare for the final set. Four people will get orange squares, two people will get the yellow triangles, and two people will get the blue triangles. We have the blue triangles go to 3 and 4 respectively. The oranges stack at 1, and the yellow triangles stand at their own yellow markers at B and 2. After that third set goes off, the stage will turn back to normal and she'll soon start to cast Obliteration again. Then she'll tether to two crystals and cast Cast. Dodge these AoEs, and for this one, you'll want your whole party to stack together, because behind you, there will be a giant laser blast coming from the big boss at the back of the stage. After that, we flip the boss and face her towards the south. After Obliteration comes out again, we then pull her to the southern edge of the stage. This repositioning makes it a lot easier for the party to react to a knockback mechanic a bit later. She'll then cast Stock, which is where she'll tether to two crystals and save their AoE patterns for later. So you'll need to memorize which AoE pattern it is for now. At the same time, you'll want to get into your party groups. Stack AoEs appear on each healer, so you'll want to be in your groups, and once those AoEs go off, you'll place down two dudes. The dudes are not targetable and cannot be moved when they're placed. Everyone will then get a tether attached to a dude with a number on their head. Four people will get tethered to one dude, while the other four people will get tethered to the other dude. The dudes will soon laser beam your face in the order of your numbers. The laser will come from the dude that you're tethered to. The boss then casts Rapturous Reach, which is the left or the right side AoE. The dude's laser goes off on the number one person as soon as that AoE cast completes, so you'll want to be in your spot or in positions to take the laser to the face pretty fast. Then everyone else takes their laser to the face in numerical order. On the second laser hit, the big boss behind you will light up one of his hands on either the left or the right side. This is where the knockback will come from. Once the number four people are finished with their lasers, move to that side in preparation to get knockback through the center of the stage to the other side. After that knockback, she'll cast Release, which you have to remember which AoE pattern you had before when she casted Stock, so then just dodge that accordingly. Obliteration will happen next, followed by Formless Judgment, which is the Tank Busters. She'll then cast Stalk, so remember which AoE configuration happens here, and now we get into Lions, which is arguably one of the most difficult mechanics in the entire raid tier. This is where our mark positions come into play, so let's go over everything that happens here. Four small lions appear at the east and west sides of the stage, and two big lions appear, one at the north and one at the south. The four small lions will tether to either four DPS or the healers and the tanks. So to start us off this phase, four people will get tethers and four people will not. Let's go over the movement and positions for those who have tethers first. Then we'll come back to the folks who don't have tethers. First, the boss will cast Rapturous Reach, which is the half room AoE. You'll want to dodge this first and then go to your tether position. You'll want to create this pattern with your tethers. The folks with the tether must stand on the corner of their markers. Fire breaths will go off, and now pop your anti-knockbacks. Come back to the middle for a quick set of heals, and then get back to your marker corner. The second fire breath will go off, and now is the time to dodge the AoE configuration you got from her stock cast earlier. Now, go back to your marker spot on the corner and take the third lion's breath. Rapturous Reach will then come out one last time, so dodge that accordingly, and you're all finished with this mechanic. For the people who don't have tethers, you'll want to assign two people for the north lion and two people for the south lion. Here's the movement for them. The big lions will fire breath the closest person to them, and whether you get the north or the south lions, the movement is exactly the same. On the south side, I'm the one that's going to go first. So I watch out for the Rapturous Reach AoE coming from the middle. Don't forget, it's a little bit wider than the 180 degree AoE that we're used to. So once that goes off, I make my way to this spot here and point the lion towards the outside. A lava AoE drops on the stage and the first fire breath comes out. The person who's not baiting the big lions first. They'll stand here at the edge of the marker. Make sure that you're not too close to the big lion or else it'll target you and fire breath towards the middle of the stage. The position for standing on this marker is extremely precise. The person who took the first fire breath will have a debuff on them, so they can't take the second fire breath, but that debuff falls off, so they can take the third. After the first breath, pop your anti-knockbacks, move towards the center of the stage for quick heals, and then you'll switch. The person who just took the first fire breath will stand here at the marker, while the other person bait the second lion breath towards the outside of the stage, standing exactly here, or here on the other side. Another lava AoE will drop down as well. One thing we noticed in our runs is that if you go to the edge of the stage, the big lions will most likely fire breath towards the person at the marker, leaving the middle of the stage. So you just want to make sure that you're standing on this exact spot as that bait distance is really precise for those big lions. After the second lion breath goes off, move to your AoE's safe spots from before, switch positions, and the person who baited the first fire breath will now take the third, while the person who took the second fire breath will stand back at the marker. After that's all done, make sure you dodge left or right as Rapturous Reach comes out, and you're all good to go. One other thing that comes to mind is that even though we found this strategy with lions to be very precise and tricky during progression on where we stand, no matter who got what during that phase, everyone could hit the boss for max DPS uptime. Next, she'll cast another Obliteration, and then cast Stalk, saving an AoE pattern for later. She'll then cast either Junction Shiva or Junction Titan, so it'll be spread out or stack with your healer groups. She'll then cast, so look for the tethers and dodge the AoE pattern that comes out, then spread or stack again. Come back into the middle for another Obliteration, so heal up. Then she'll cast Junction Shiva or Junction Titan again, so spread or stack. Also note that this junction will always be opposite than the first junction you got a few mechanics ago. She'll also cast Release, which will place down the AoE configuration from her stock ability a few mechanics ago as well. So dodge the AoE and then stack or spread. Next, the Tank Buster, Formless Judgment, will come out for one last time, so do that properly, followed by two more obliterations and an auto attack. The boss will then become untargetable and enrage if you haven't gotten her health down to 0.1%. But if you have the DPS, then congratulations, you've defeated the hardest door boss in Final Fantasy since Faust and Alexander. A few things to keep in mind is that if you're progressing on phase 2 and you can clear the door boss no problem, if you wipe, make sure to reset the instance timer after 2 or 3 pulls. Since the timer of the instance doesn't reset once you defeat the door boss, you'll want as much time as possible to work on phase 2. If you're in phase 2 and leave the instance, once you come back in, you'll have to defeat the door boss again. But the good thing with this door boss's DPS check is that if you have enough DPS to clear, then you'll have enough DPS to clear phase 2. As always, it's just learning mechanics and putting in the hours. And hopefully this guide has helped you out in your progression. And if you've made it this far in a video, hey, thanks for sticking around. These videos are extremely time consuming to make, so if you want to help out the channel by giving it a like or subscribe, that would really help out. And it would be a huge encouragement to myself and a lot of you guys out there who depend on these guides for your clears. And I especially want to thank my raid team and my raid leader Venom for taking the time to study up on all of these fights so the rest of us can come in, clear this fight easy peasy. So if you see any of them in game, give them a shout out too. And I can't wait to hear from all of you about your clears as well. So until next time, enjoy the raid, enjoy the fights, and keep on adventuring.